In the wee hours of Thursday the 30th, WarnerMedia's next adult animated venture was quietly released to explosive interest and muted viewing. The Prince, the long controversial project headed by one of Family Guy's executive producers, Gary Jannetty, had its initial April launch pushed back due to the unexpected but unsurprising death of Prince Philip, Duke of Edinburgh. With the trailer dropping only the day before, many were eager to search for its whereabouts, but few, like me, were poised to exhibit its contents. It was unexpected, really. Not sure how, but the trailer made it seem like we were edging into nuclear cringe, so I was kind of psyched to watch it. I mean, what other trailer of the year is going to end in an aborted cutaway gag?
Ooh, certainly, sir. I haven't had this much fun.
Okay, well, of course it's more fun than whatever life event you were about to reference.
But you know, I'm quite proud of you. Yeah, you. In the audience. Collectively, nobody that's tangentially interested in the HBO Max animated library, or I guess the rest of the cartoon community, seem to give a single iota of a fuck about the Prince. And for that,
I salute you.
Ironically, the significant few I see publicizing this whole affair would be the volunteer guard dogs of the Queen that mauled about the series, making a mockery of the royal children. And it's kind of annoying because you can tell how far removed from the situation they are and how much they don't really understand the process. I'm likely the only one around for miles who actually bothered to sit down and watch the whole thing in one go. I can tell you, if they had watched it, they would be way more outraged. I sunk 2 hours into watching it. I had thoughts going in. Spoilers, because you're not watching this shit anyway, right? Right. Let's knock out some technicals. The show looks fine. Its character design genuinely feels kind of adjacent to Family Guy due to certain design elements. The eyes, the proportioning, the really graphic caricatures of the royals. Even the movement design mimics it rather closely.
Ooh, Kelly Ripper just posted a Throwback Thursday photo of her eating a bagel on the set of All My Children. OMG, coffin emoji.
The voice acting is plain decent. Half the character voices are either trying to play up two-dimensional comedic aspects or keep it just a little bit more grounded. The kids are presumably an odd mix of both. Some of the Real Housewives and Andy Cohen get a little more screen time than Prince Louis, but I don't particularly mind. I think the opening sequence is cool. Divorced from the actual subject matter and tone, it feels like it could prepare you for something more. I'm also a cheap bitch that enjoys musicals, so however minor, I'm obligated to highlight the 4-minute number nestled in the back half of the show. Not telling you which episode. The show does keep a few loose threads hanging by the end of it, quite a few subplots and art set up, but not really delivered on, even in a way that could simultaneously satisfy and keep the momentum up for a presumed second season. A lot of these make themselves clear by the second or third episode again, so I don't consider them spoilers. There are a couple of pairs of workers around the castle that we occasionally hold on. A revenge plot is present through most of the show, but we don't really get a concrete glimpse of what may transpire until the very end. One member of the royal family is a Russian spy. No guesses as to who, though. Prince Philip may be the only family member that gets progressive character development. The restraint involved with only killing him off 3/4 the way through is just effervescent. Once he's revived, he functions more like an actual person rather than fodder for cheap gags, which is odd, but man, I'll take it. There are 3 episodes in the second half of the show centered around George's school play. They took the time to try and haphazardly focus on George and Owen, his butler's rapport. I find this significant in Jannetty's case. He's not only been a long-haul producer, Family Guy, but each of the 12 episodes he's written have been focused on Brian and Stewie, whether as a pair or by themselves. These episodes are no slouch either. Plenty of these served as defining points for both characters. He even penned the script to the recent entry where the latter is shrinked by Sir Ian McKellen in therapy.
Don't do this, Stewie. It will stay with you forever.
Yeah, not worried. For me, this is kinda no bigs.
Anyway, the relationship between the two is subtly pronounced in this mini-arc of sorts, by a bit of self-doubt in George, a bit of backstory in Owen, and a possible self-revelation from the former not long before the curtains rise.
Everyone tells me how great I am at everything, but I'm not sure. Are they just saying this because of who I am? How will I ever know what's true and what's not?
Now, this moment could veer off in 12 different directions, but I think there's only two that we could reasonably surmise. Spoiled child finds out the truth, makes some kind of gradual change to improve himself. Spoiled child finds out the truth and completely ignores this.
It's important to hear the truth and not just surround ourselves with people who tell us only what we want to hear. That's how we grow.
After hearing Owen's speech, take a minute to figure out how you think this show, this one in particular, would proceed. I'll give you a moment. I'll wait. Took a moment to think about it? All right, let's roll it.
I see. Thank you. You're fired.
Excuse me?
You're fired. Get out.
Yep, that's pretty much it. And after this, we get no glimpse of the play. No glimpse of how everything turned out. We don't really get to see their thought processes. Just a very casual reset of the prince's canon where new Owen lavishes him with praise and any investment is just dunked out the window. So, generally, while it does attempt some larger continuity and arc-bearing elements, the prince seems like an underachiever to me, much in the vein of the family it satirizes throughout its 12-episode run. As much as it does expend a bit of effort to craft a real story, its follow-through on these elements, with respect to its limited run, is pretty lackluster from a creative lead who I know can do much better. I do wonder if it would even be allowed to exist on terrestrial TV, in which case it may have been a rank case of substandard concepts once again failing upwards. As biased as I am, I think Little Bush at least had some crude charm to it, and hey, it made history as far as mobile distribution for animation goes. Though generally it leaves less of an impression than a lightly salted oyster cracker, I'd hasten to say that the prince perhaps made it out better than most. It's one of many other experiments and projects produced in the last 10 to 20 years that establishes a specific base within the annals of adult animation. A subsection known for breaking from the mold with raunchy but artistically challenging works are now largely known as stiff, cheap, and highly derivative from a certain mold. Family Guy itself has basically become synonymous with a specific group of design trends the same way CalArts has, except it's a little more socially acceptable. And while the prince didn't inspire much confidence or investment in its success, it did make me ponder its existence. Had there not been a deliberate effort to sweep it under the rug, it likely would be immortalized in the vein of Hoops and Paradise PD, only the latest in the line of these apparently new age adult cartoons. It begs the question, is adult animation really that bad? The subgenre itself has been around almost as long as animation itself. There were folks putting together X-rated animated films years before the first feature film. The classification of cartoons has been a tricky subject for a while, though generally the most prolific IPs to come out of the Golden Age were considered family viewing, likely because it summed up the content sufficiently, but also because it was the most financially pertinent move to go with. These subsections don't officially become classifications in their own right until it becomes a monetary incentive, much in the vein that bigger studios had to warm up to the idea of producing content for television. So I imagine the terms didn't grab wider attention until the success of The Simpsons, or more relevant to this essay's thesis, Family Guy.
I've decided to kill you all in an excruciating manner. What do you say to that? I'm glad you're all on board.
Predictably so, other juggernauts of the past have contributed to or inspired other concepts getting produced, either in concept or during development. Studios and networks looking to chase the rampant success of the biggest icons appropriated a lot of visual and tonal sensibilities. A fair amount of wackier family-based sitcoms were given the floor in a similar vein to The Simpsons or The Griffins. Concurrently, a general interest in the genre led to the creation of a lot of different and interesting premises. Adult Swim was definitely leading the charge under the radar, but good entertainment came from all over. Fox, ABC, NBC, TBS, Comedy Central, MTV, Spike, IFC, Sci-Fi, UPN, the WB, VH1, even unsuspecting culprits like PBS and Playboy TV have gotten in on it. Not to mention the international sector. Throughout the 2000s, there have been dozens of series, roughly three times the size of the output of the 90s, conceived for terrestrial TV, and the wide bounty of web cartoons pretty much is spoken for. Plenty more without penetrating the zeitgeist to become notable for their differences as well as their similarities. Obviously, a lot has changed since then. The rise of streaming wars and original production for online platforms has led to a boom within media itself. The ongoing reboot culture, along with the strain of the current situation, have exacerbated the need to fill up content libraries with new or returning IPs and hit margins while other parts of entertainment falter and fall behind. Animation's been cited as a solid beacon during the last 18 months, as it's a flexible medium that is pretty forgiving in a scenario where work from home is a must. You've already had perfectly completed series, films, and translation jobs done during the ensuing chaos. We're only about a year and a half into the decade, but our output in adult animation is comparable to the 90s. By the halfway mark, we'll likely have more movies and shows than we can count. Of course, quantity does not automatically factor into quality. We haven't seen too many in this realm, but there have been reboots and adaptations made for or skewing towards adult audiences. The few we've seen aren't too bad, but of course our focus is centered around the originals. Shows like Hoops, Brickleberry, or Paradise PD, Our Cartoon President, Big Mouth, depending on who you talk to, Legends of Chamberlain Heights, Border Town, basically the rest of the Fox cartoons that weren't Bob's Burgers, ADHD lineup qualifies too. Probably a couple others that didn't give folks good vibes, so to speak. They were always the centerpiece of the great debate. Why are adult cartoons poorly made? Now, obviously, there's enough of the wacky, comedically focused buddy comedies or the group of characters sitcom style set up to lampoon. I'm inclined to agree that they share some design similarities, sure. Though running with the Go Animate or Family Guy style shtick for all of them gets excessive, admittedly. Like, I don't think Family Guy is a fraction as derivative as The Simpsons as people pretend it is, but it's undeniable that it owes much of its existence to the latter's success and such. I'm not gonna act like derivative content doesn't exist, but surely all this molding has been shown to not move the needle at this point, right? Some derivatives do well, some don't, but even if they had visual similarities, and they start to blur together after a while, enough of them try to do something different anyway. Big Mouth does carry that stiff, round look to it, but its structure is obviously a bit fluid as a running narrative. Not to mention the times where they ramp up their fluidity or their visual design for something more ambitious. Of course, as far as writing goes, many tend to default to the unwritten standards in many's eyes. You know, the really edgy or really sardonic show that relies on pop culture references, gross out, and generally off-putting comedy to carry it forward. There are enough shows that look the part, but are pretty different from such a standard. Even when they do fit to a T, there are occasionally cheerleaders in their court that can point to an aspect of it that can arouse some interest in it. I know the perception is that they were made to make bank and run, but I know even going with that narrative walks a fine line and shitting on someone else's ideas, like footage related, and actually calling out what seems to be a true blue cash grab like the IP featured in the title of this video. Many have recently been made aware of this thread discussing the real challenges of those who work in the adult animation pipeline, like high turnaround, low pay, and a really punitive and tight system to hitting the learning curve. Similarly, I've seen a crew member here or there rail against the prints itself. I've learned from this review that the show is based on this weird series of Instagram posts Jannetty had made and gained praise for satirizing the royals. We can have the satire debate all day, but personally it's less about the kids and more about, I don't know, Meghan and Camilla getting dragged the way they were. The way these posts were hidden in the midst of production is quite fascinating, honestly. If you had to take away anything from this, remember, the people that worked on this probably don't align with this, gonna be honest, slimy rhetoric. And yeah, someone created an idea, but there's always suits and bigwigs involved that alter the original vision. It's probably the reason why Meghan got the sympathetic end of the stick in the series at large, when this man was literally shitting on her for eons and eons. People need to keep in mind that at the end of the day, this is always someone's first gig or someone else's proudest work. So you got to focus on the work itself and not overgeneralize about the crew or the show or anything. So are they all the same? Are we challenged by being stuck in a perpetual state of receiving the exact same content in a different package? Because it seems to me that we have it better than most. Much, much better than most. Like I said, the last year and a half has been pretty much saturated with adult cartoons. Comedies are always in vogue, but we've gotten so many other genres, settings, and premises to work with. Talented and forward-thinking people put to helm really ambitious ideas, have done so with flying colors, and it shows. The new reckoning of the next generation has given us a whole slew of stuff to work with. Shit, I know I have mine. HBO's Animals is a really witty but grounded series, placing it in the lens of the various animalian cast of New York City, and I haven't finished it yet, but it's got a really cool style visually and narratively in it, and it takes you to quite a few places. I still think Mike Tyson Mysteries is fairly underrated. Many wouldn't guess that it's actually a really funny and witty riff on the ancient Hanna-Barbera mystery comedies of the 70s. Ballmasters 9009 remains one of the best sports-related cartoons in this subsection for its high energy amongst its steady narrative. Moonbeam City and Ugly Americans got overlooked so quickly, and I am still burned about it, because in the character building department, they both rock. Laser Wolf Season 1 has been really captivating, and Tuca and Birdie Season 2 has been really illuminating. They both make for a great Sunday night watch. Admittedly, I have a soft spot for Forget About It as an occasional, very occasional guilty pleasure. I'd be a bored leave out my man Peepoodoo despite his segregation from the rest of the pack. I think I've made my stance on Duncanville pretty clear. Though pour one out for Bless the Hearts, that one got ripped from us too soon. And I have never spoken to someone who watched Last Man and hated it. Myself included. These and plenty others help make up the great tapestry of adult animation. There's no denying that many of these wouldn't be possible without the success of the significant few. The new guard have clearly paved a way regardless. The amount of new projects getting love and attention is pretty vast. The investment justifies itself, arguably more so than the traditional sitcom. If anything, cartoons cut from the same cloth of the old guard are more rare than newer stuff. This is literally a moot point of contention. You can't say that there are more slacker cats than Supermansions. We could be talking about issues that affect the people making the shows, like the workload or the crunch or the lack of unionization or, I don't know, harassment. And as lowly consumers, it would obviously be difficult to broach by ourselves without overstepping boundaries, but it seems like it serves a much better use than continually having these tired, lazy, derivative, and cheap circle jerks about the same few ideas that punch down just as much as said targets, instead of ignoring them and just supporting the better content. As industry folks have said, they make bank anyway. And instead of continuing to feeding into this feedback loop, we could literally just be uplifting the ones that get it right. Surprisingly, it wasn't the fault of the general community this time, again, big ups for that, but due to the ceaseless whinging about shows like this, the Prince seems to have found a second wind. It's definitely, well, probably, but almost definitely not copping a renewal of any kind. But the constant attention these goofies have been given it propelled it to HBO Max's trending tab. A win of sorts for the show, and it has remained there for a startlingly long amount of time. These allegations of poor form and unnecessary targeting likely mean jack or shit for Gary Jannetty and the other higher-ups who got their payments and are sitting pretty. And it will continue to mean nothing to everybody else who creates these so long as we keep giving them gas. So to recap, cartoons in the vein of the Prince have been around for eons, they're not new, and they're not a sign of the downfall of adult animation. They exist because people have margins, and creatives gotta eat. And while it's understandable to dislike them, the last people that should be getting shit for it are the artists and production staff. Working on these easily make them some of the roughest, toughest cowboys in the industry's Wild West, and they should have your respect and your sympathy. There's way more stuff going on behind the scenes. And there are ways to discuss them without taking a big fat L. Engaging with them well will likely lead to more events like Took and Birdie's surprise renewal, and engaging with them poorly will be the reason why the Prince was trending at number 1 while Jellystone was trailing at number 7. So maybe, just maybe, we can retire this line of thought for more than a month or so. We've been given a hell of a run of adult animation so far, and while there are some serious stinkers, we've had way more introspective and specialized programs than any other point in time. Even the more crass and edgy of them have something to offer, though it may be hard to see. Surely there's something for everyone, and the sooner we can shut up and put that before the constant memeing on this genre, the sooner we can dismantle these stigmas and talking points. And maybe, just maybe, we can put some distance between these terrible, terrible trending stats.